report your arrival to the ICU, report where you're going, what you're doing. Okay, so size up the building from the outside and report fire alarm via radio of the conditions observed. We had a fire years ago over here in Forest Park, 4451 Forest Park. I was not there that day. I was off. I was on an off day, H day, O day, whatever it was, I don't know. But apparently, when the companies arrived in the front of the building, it looked like nothing. It wasn't until somebody went all the way around to the back of the building and saw fire shooting out of an apartment in the back. So, outside 360 of high-rise is as important, if not more important, than a regular structure fire, a house fire. A high-rise can be rather large. I mean, it could take up a whole block at times. So, we have to kind of get over this complacency thing. You know, it's real tempting that we just, alarm's on it. We probably got dry cocaine, whatever. Let's go on up, check it out, and then we'll go on. Well, you know, you could really put yourself in a bad spot if you don't know what you're going into. Life safety is the first priority. Locate the alarm panel and verify fire floor. That's going to be a priority for us as the first in. And while we're doing that, we're going to be more than likely on the lobby level. So it's going to kind of coincide with the with us assuming command until the second in company or second in officer gets in. Identify which stairwell will be used for attack and which for evacuation. That's an important thing to communicate early on. If we know the building ahead of time, it makes it that much easier. We can have a pre-plan and we can just make that announcement automatically. If we don't, we're gonna have to kind of assess the situation and see how many stairwells there are and make a determination on that, make sure that everybody's clear on it. Placing an attack line, this is in bold print, in operation is the primary mission of this company. I think we're all pretty familiar with how to do that. We talked a lot about that a few weeks ago. You know, we're gonna go to the floor below, we're gonna flake the line, we're gonna hook in and flake the line up to the floor above. While we're doing that, the second in company is gonna be going to the fire floor and trying to assess the situation. I don't know if it says it in here, but while we're on the floor below, it's very valuable information to kind of get a feel of the layout of that floor. Majority of times the floors are going to be structured in the same manner. Contact building reps to obtain information, gain control of the elevators, unable to gain firefighter service of the elevator, they must use the stairs. I think we've all been in that situation at least once or twice. It sucks, but that's just the way it is. I was on a squad one time, and it was about 6:45 in the morning. We were just about to be relieved. Got a first alarm fire for a high-rise downtown. Turned out to be nothing, thank God. It was insulation burning in the HVAC unit on the roof. We couldn't gain control of the elevators. Chief told us to take the stairs. We got up about 18 flights of stairs, and they said, Okay, we got an elevator for you now. It's coming up. And we get in the elevator and it goes straight down to the lobby. Fortunately, we were able to make it go back up again, but what a feeling, man. I was like, man, it took us a long time to get up 18 flights of stairs with all that equipment.
Well, yeah, a lot of times, you know, people hit the button. Oh, it's out here, it's taking stairs. You gotta be, it's going to take you 10 minutes to walk up 20 flights of stairs.
Yeah. I mean, this is kind of out of our control. The chief's probably going to make that determination, but I think the idea of it is, once they get control of the elevators, they'll set them up. But you have to go under the assumption that they're not going to be able to get control. We can't just sit down there in the lobby forever and ever and, you know, not.
Right, but you can't turn the key and expect all the elevators to be like that. You know,
yeah.
You're going to recall it takes a few seconds for them to get down there. As long as you see that movement towards you, you know, that's the thing is, you know, at least try to get the elevators, don't just say, yeah, oh, take the steps.
Or the first thing coming takes the elevator up there, and
right,
leaves it up there, and then nobody else has to take the steps.
Yeah, if somebody has to be left with that elevator, you want the elevator, that happens too.
Yeah. Gas, liquid gas going downtown. We had a pretty good fire there. And the city just took the elevator up and locked it up there. And we all had to take the steps. It was on like the 21st floor, 20th floor.
Okay, so. And a 2.5-inch standby pack will be utilized if the occupancy dictates. Jeff and I were at a seminar over in Collinsville not too long ago, and there was a very good point raised. When you're in a wide open area, this was more to do with warehouses, I think, but I think, you know, some high-rise floors are big open areas, and this would pertain to that too. It might be wise to use a 2.5 just to get more distance. And you know what? I don't know. Will a 2.5 go further than an 1.75? Because you're shooting more volume instead of pressure.
It probably should, especially if they we take that fog tip off and just use a smooth blower.
Well, you know, I'm thinking if you got anything at all in a high rise, we need to be thinking about 2.5 right off the bat. You know, that it would be wise to use a 2.5 right off the bat because you don't want to get up there and just be pissing on the fire while it's growing and people are getting trapped and all that.
Bitch. Well, that's why the second and the third inch coming now is supposed to take 2.5. Now you should be going a little sooner than later. You know, third inch is supposed to take half of 2.5, so you've got that 2.5 flight schedule.
So, I mean,
I've never seen that happen.
We get up in there,